Good evening. Thanks for coming out. You get to now experience me reading with a conversational tone, hopefully. Quietly and steadily, Carmen Herrera has worked in what she described about a decade ago as a process of lifelong purification, a process of taking away what isn't essential. And much has been said regarding the extent to which Carmen Herrera's work has been underseen and has remained on the outside of the main ongoing conversation of formal painting over the last century. I personally didn't know this work until 2007, when the painter Donald Moffitt suggested I look at the work. I had been bugging Donald at the time for various reasons, emailing him endlessly. He was making a series of paintings at the time called the Fleisch series, which definitely dealt with issues of how a painting is inextricably hooked up to objecthood, how a painting is an object and how color is form and form is color. And these are all issues that present themselves in the world endlessly. And they're issues that Carmen Herrera tackled and brought to the fore of collective thought as early as 50, 60 years ago. So at the time, I receive an email from Donald that simply said, Carmen Herrera, Federico Seve. I knew the gallery somewhat, peripherally, and I, of course, went. And I was struck, first by the utter clarity of the work, and then, as it became clear, also by the length of this career and the confident and apparent indefatigable voice of this artist that I did not know. If you jump ahead to May of last year, as I walked through Carmen Herrera's exhibition at Listen Gallery in New York, in part in anticipation for the show that Dana Miller was organizing at the Whitney Museum of American Art, that is now in our galleries, I was struck again, essentially. This was a recent works show by a person that was 100 years old. And it spoke of something that is tireless and disciplined in Carmen Herrera's practice. It was full of logic and joy in, if not equal, at least good measure. Lines of Sight, which is very thoughtfully and respectfully curated by our guest, one of our guests tonight, Dana Miller, is, as most of you know now, a wonder. And a clear look at a very crucial section of a trajectory of an astonishing career. The years between 1947 and 1978, when these methods and ideas were being developed and refined and practiced. And we're very happy to have Dana Miller here tonight in conversation with Tony Bechara, Carmen's longtime friend. Dana Miller, until very recently, was the Richard DeMartini family curator and director of collections at the Whitney Museum of American Art. And Dana was at the Whitney for two decades and did remarkable work there. She co-curated the fascinating, beautiful, and complex show called Human Interest, Portraits from the Whitney's Collection, which is up for another 2 weeks. It's one floor up from the Whitney, or from the Biennial, if you're in New York, and it's beautiful. And she also was part of the team that organized the inaugural exhibition at the Whitney's new downtown building, America is Hard to See. She also organized a show in 2012 that's very important to me, the Jay DeFeo retrospective, and authored its equally incredible catalog. Tony Bechara is an artist that lives and works in New York and whose paintings tackle the phenomenological questions that explore the history of problems associated with representation, the visual and visuality itself. Tony has been awarded a fellowship from the National Endowment for the Arts, which apparently we'll need to stridently defend as, I'm sorry? Well, It's been blithely put on the chopping block, so prepare yourselves. He has participated in exhibitions at the Whitney Museum of American Art, PS1 in Long Island City, New York, the Museo del Barrio, the Museum of Latin American Arts in California, amongst many others. So please welcome Dana Miller and Tony Bechara.
Thank you, Michael, for that incredibly gracious and lovely introduction. I do want to just say one thing about Tony, which is that I really consider him my partner in this endeavor. Tony has been Carmen's neighbor and friend and, conciliary and everything for the last several decades. And it really wouldn't have been possible for me to do this if Tony hadn't been there as a sounding board and as a resource and as a translator. Carmen hears beautifully most days, but there are times when she responds to a male Spanish-speaking voice better than mine. So I just want to say that up front and that I'm very grateful, and I can't imagine a person that I would more happily share the stage with speaking about Carmen than Tony.
You're being overly kind.
No, not really. We thought we would start with a little biographical information about Carmen because it's purposefully absent from the show. It's very much present in the catalog, but it's really not that much present in the show. You get little dribs and drabs, and you learn that, you know, Carmen faced certain adversities because she was a woman, because she was an immigrant. But this was a purposeful choice on my part as a curator to really leave the biography sort of to the catalog and to the kind of secondary layer of examination. And it's, I think, a conundrum for curators, how much of the biography to bring into monographic shows. And it was something that I struggled with when I did the Jay DeFeo show. And I think it is a fine line, especially when you're dealing with women artists, that the biography sometimes has a way of taking over the work itself. And my feeling was that Carmen worked for so many years to have her work seen that I wanted that to be the story and not that there was a 100-year-old woman who had labored in obscurity for 70 years. And there was a Gorilla Girls slide that I had seen many years ago that said something like, you know, how to be a famous female artist, and it said, you know, die young of a brain tumor like Eva Hess, or have a much more famous, you know, husband who dies early. Or labor in obscurity for many, many years. And I just thought, you know, that shouldn't be Carmen's story. You know, I wanted people to walk into the galleries, see the work, and be overwhelmed by the work itself. But I think the biography is important, and people are always fascinated by it. So given that you've expressed interest in her work and in her beyond just the show, we're going to start with a little biography. And I think Tony probably is the better person to speak to some of these images, family images from.
This is a particularly important image because when you speak to Carmen Herrera, you're speaking to someone who was really founded, informed, created by the 19th century, not the 20th century, the 19th century. In this photograph, that's Carmen with the bow, and the rest are her siblings. That photograph was taken, I think, in 16 or 17.
It says 17 on the caption,
I think. The year that the first war started. And everything about that photograph says 19th century. The dress, the setting, and that's why I think that's very important, that this woman that we're talking about saddles three centuries. She's formed by the morals and the education and the influences of the 19th and the 20th, and is, of course, to this day still working in the 21st century. That photograph, for me, it's a symbol of that.
I also love, she's the youngest of seven, including five brothers. So I think that you get a sense that she had to sort of fight to be heard even back then.
Yeah.
So So this is a photograph that we believe is taken in Havana in, we think, the 30s sometime.
She's in the 30s, yeah.
Painting. Mm-hmm. And Carmen's early arts education was in Havana. And she had a very sort of stop-and-go education. Many of the schools that she was attending throughout all of her education would either be closed because of a strike or there was a revolution. And it was, you know, a series of political sort of, you know, tumults, revolutions that made it very hard for her to have a continuous education. And so when she finally entered university to study architecture, I think she was 22 or 23 at the time, you know, very, very late. But some of her early arts education was in drawing and painting, but I think importantly, and this is something we'll come back to when we talk about the later work, she was also working in sculpture. So she was thinking about the three dimensions very early on. Materials were very easy to come by there, especially mahogany. And then, so here's actually a photograph of her at a show that was done in an outside park in 1937 in Havana. And the show was done outside in part to protest the lack of available spaces for artists to show their work in Havana. And Tony was telling me that Carmen was really the instigator.
She was. she really organized the exhibit. There she is, the only woman in that group. The rest of the artists there are somewhat well-known. One especially, Cundo Bermudez, is well-known today. Unfortunately, all have, Carmen has outlived them all. But this was in a park in Havana in 1937. And they would get up in the morning and hang the paintings from the trees, and then in the evening put them away, and do that every day for 3 or 4 weeks. And Carmen remembers it as being one of the most popular cultural events in Havana at the time.
And I think it's important that she is represented there, very much a part of the mix. She had a community of like-minded artists in Havana at that time, and she was well respected. And she may have been one of the few women, but she was participating, which is a difference in something that, you know, becomes more of a challenge for her in the United States. So this is one of the sculptures that she made that was included in this show in 37. And it's a wooden carving of the face of Christ set upon another wooden panel on which she has painted a swastika. And inscribed on the back of a photo that we have of it, she describes it as a protest against the Nazis.
It's not only, it's in mahogany, and it's not only the face of Christ, but it's a lacrima Christi. In other words, it's like a Christ with a tear. And she did it crucified Christ on a swastika. And 1937, you know, I remember, I mean, I am a fan of history and of especially that period, and I would always ask her, what did you know in 37? I mean, oh, she said, everybody knew. She says, but today everybody talks about no one knew until 47. She says, they knew in 37. If I knew in Havana, she says, they knew everywhere else. And she did that piece, which to me was extraordinary. Unfortunately, the swastika and the Christ were part of a museum in Cuba, and somehow the swastika has disappeared. The photographic evidence is there. That's one of the pieces that she showed at that plein air exhibition at the park.
I think that's the image of it hanging from a tree.
On a post, yeah.
Yeah, right there. So this is Carmen and her the love of her life, Jesse Lowenthal, whom she met in Cuba. Her older brother, Addison, was living in New York working for NBC News, and he would from time to time send a friend down to Cuba with a letter of introduction to go find his family, and you know, these people would be shown around Cuba. And Carmen tells the story that, you know, the doorbell would ring and someone would say, "I'm a friend of Addison's," and like they would all, you know, kind of run and hide because nobody wanted to take the turn of showing the tourist around. But Jesse showed up, and that began, I mean, a really wonderful love affair.
Yeah. Yeah, he died at the age almost 100. He was maybe 15 or 16 years older than Carmen, and died in the year 2000, was born 1900 or 1901. Jesse was a friend of mine as well. And he is really pivotal, very important. He was an intellectual. He taught at a very special high school in New York, or Stuyvesant High School, which is for really excellent students. Jesse was fluent in German, Spanish, French, Italian. And I knew him at the age of 92. He wanted to read the Greek classics in the ancient Greek. And he sat down and he taught himself Greek, classic Greek. He was extraordinary. His group was extraordinary. He was very good. He went to school with Barnett Newman. He was good friends with Mark Rothko, with the poet Louis Sukovsky, and with many other figures. You have to understand that at the time that he was being formed educationally, there was something called the Jewish quota in Harvard. And they would only allow a certain amount of Jews otherwise, because they were too smart, supposedly. Jesse and Barnett and Barney and this group concentrated in New York on City University, and they turned that university into a mini Harvard. And Jesse was born, he's a German, of German Jewish origins, born in the Bronx, but in a household where they were still speaking German. And he was an expert on poetry in several languages, and someone that is really pivotal in the life. Their relationship was amazing. I've never seen a marriage, it's probably the only marriage I've ever seen that worked, and, including mine. And quite a character. You know the book Angela's Ashes?
It's Teacher Man, I think, that he's in, right?
Teacher Man, but yeah. The author, right.
Frank McCourt
describes him, you know.
Yeah.
He used to go to school wearing a collar and a tie.
Three-piece suit and a pocket watch.
He was what we call in New York a mensch.
It's interesting because Jesse also stretched her canvases for her, built her stretchers, yeah. Stretched her canvases. You know, he was in some ways her studio assistant. And I don't know if you all have seen the Netflix movie about Carmen, but I still think about this. I can't remember if it ended up making the final movie or not, but Allison Clayman, who made the film, when she interviewed me, you know, she's a very good filmmaker, and she likes to get a rise out of her interview subjects. And she just kept kind of poking me about how important Jesse was to Carmen, and of course he was, but then I finally kind of snapped back at her and said, you know, well, would you be asking me these same questions if there was a woman behind a male artist who, you know, right. Was cooking and cleaning and taking care of the kid, you know, or some, and I don't know if it came in or not, but, you know, it's an interesting way to kind of think about the dynamics of what it takes to become a successful female artist. But Jesse, by all accounts, and I would on random occasions be taking people through the museum, and it was, you know, turned out to be somebody who had been his student at Stuyvesant. And they right. all tell stories, amazing, wonderful stories about him. And we have love letters that we went through as part of the research. It's really very romantic. This is a photo of Carmen on the way to their honeymoon, right?
I don't know if you know, Have you heard of the Mexican city called Monterrey? That is downtown Monterrey. She was on her way to Acapulco in 1939, and they got off, doing this by train. And they got off the train in Acapulco. Jesse was a wonderful photographer. He had a Hasselblad, or a Leica, I don't know, one of the two. And he took this photograph. And people that I know from Monterrey immediately recognize the mountain range. It's called the Saddle, La Silla. And they say, but that's now in, well, that is now in the center of one of the biggest industrial cities of Mexico. Then it was a little village. That's in Washington Square Park.
Yeah, it's very much to our benefit that Jesse photographed Carmen as much as he did. So here are two paintings that showed up, I would say, relatively late in our research project. Mm-hmm. I think only one's illustrated in the book. But we were looking for works that Carmen was making after she came to New York in 1939. So she and Jesse moved to New York in 1939 and lived in a variety of places, downtown or in Gramercy. And she was really experimenting, trying to find her own. But this is the moment where she shifts from looking at sculpture and architecture. And I should say that when she was in Havana and she did 1 year at university, she was studying to be an architect. And she says that this is crucial to understanding her work, that she wouldn't think the way she does, she wouldn't draw the way she does, and her paintings wouldn't look the way that they do if she hadn't studied architecture. And I wanted that to come through in the presentation of the show, and I think that the combination of Herrera and Sarah Oppenheimer is so brilliant in that respect, in that Carmen's paintings can be seen in many ways as kind of slices into either, you know, a three-dimensional object or cutting into space, and you have that same sensibility with Sarah's work, and also the way that Carmen would be maybe looking at a shape and rotating it in her mind. You get the sense that she's kind of turning something over, and you have that as well with Sarah. So it's a really nice synchronicity between the two. But she's going to the Art Students League. She's studying with John Corbino there, but sort of frustrated. She had been, for various reasons, in Havana studying at a women's organization called the Lyceum, because the main schools were being boycotted by the students. It was, you know, striking against the government, and she didn't want to break the strike. And then when she came to New York and worked at the Art Students League, all of the male students were off fighting the war. So she, I think, expressed some frustration in that it was always these situations where she wasn't necessarily surrounded by the most diverse mix of artists and styles. But these are, I think, really interesting as a counterpoint to what comes later, and clearly very directly figurative.
These are interesting because here they're almost a pivotal. You start seeing how she's starting to break up the space into geometric shapes, even though it's clearly a figurative work. But it suggests what is coming. That period in New York, first it's the war. People forget that during World War II in New York, there was rationing. You couldn't buy meat unless you had a little piece of paper and you were allowed only a certain quantity. So life in New York was clearly affected by the war. And Carmen is surrounded. Her English couldn't have been that well, couldn't have been that good. And she's surrounded by Jesse, who is an intellectual, who is slightly older, by the likes of Barney Newman, who is, you know, by poets, musicians, all these men that are, and here she's trying to. And her work, in a way, I think reflects that. You know, she doesn't have a studio. She doesn't have a studio. But if you go to the next slide, voila. Something happened here. For the first time, she is no longer an appendage, to Jesse. Now she has a studio.
Right.
The two of them are in a city where both of them are strangers. And she really blossomed there.
And she spoke French. She had spent 2 years in France as a teenager. Yeah. They were both Francophiles. I think she was always, she said once, I should have been born in Paris. And I think, just going back to Barney Newman, one of my favorite stories that Carmen told me is, you know, that she would listen. She said it was the best university in the world. If you have Barnett Newman, who's just pontificating for hours over dinner, that's the best university anyone could have. And she said the most important thing that he taught me was how to think about something and then do it, rather than doing something and then thinking about it afterwards. And it's so simple, but you can see that that becomes an important aspect of her work, and in its simplification. So Jesse gets a sabbatical in 48, and they leave for Paris and enter this wonderful world. Here's her studio.
She finally has a studio.
Yeah. So they are there from 48 to approximately 53, 54. We have all of her old passports, and you know, I'm the historian in me is very careful. I don't want to put 54 on Paris, but we know she doesn't return to the States until 54. We know she was in Paris through much of 53. And there, they become part of this really interesting international mix of artists, musicians, poets, playwrights, and Carmen comes into her own. She really blossoms. She's exposed to all sorts of different art, Russian suprematism, there are artists from South America, the Bauhaus, things that she hadn't seen before. And she is treated very much as an equal. She speaks French beautifully. There doesn't seem to be much chauvinism in Paris. And she becomes part of a group associated with the Salon de Réalité Nouvelle, all of whom are working in various modes of abstraction. So you see, this is a photo of her studio circa 1953. And you can see that she's now abandoned the figure. Here are her identification cards. And this is, you know,
this
very
is
prestigious.
Belonging to the salon.
It was, you know, something to be proud of. She does say that when she brought her work to be considered for the salon, that Frido Cides said to her, "Oh, these are quite something to behold, Madame. You have five paintings in this one canvas." And she was so flattered, and then she left and walked a couple of blocks and realized that that was actually an insult, and that what he was really telling her to do was to pare it down. So that one canvas with five different paintings really needed to be five different paintings. And that is the process that she goes through while she's in Paris. So in that four-year period.
That may have been the turning point. From that moment on, she really becomes a distiller.
Yeah.
And starts taking things out.
Yeah.
She said, if I take it out and it destroys the painting, then I know I took out too much.
Right.
And it was Fredo, this Hungarian fascinating man, who was at the time the leader of the Salon de Réalité Nouvelle. There's a historical context here because during the war years, abstract art was considered degenerate. And it was not accepted anywhere in areas where the fascists had influence. And Paris, of course, was under German occupation during those years. So after the war, this salon became a way of saying to abstract artists of Europe, come here, this is what we're going to show. And Carmen fit perfectly in it. And if you read the list of artists who exhibited in those days, it's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, from Max Bill, Ellsworth Kelly, everybody was part of that movement. It's very, very little well known, very little known these days, but I think a very important movement at the time.
So you see here in 48 that I think the distillation process, I mean, it's a little bit of an ebb and flow, but it begins. And certain visual preoccupations that come into play later in Carmen's work become evident for the first time. So she starts reducing her palette to three colors and then to two. You have these really interesting moments where points, you know, if you took sort of a subsection in the bottom left corner of the painting, you can see that there are these moments of sort of contact or almost contact that become really crucial. And later on, those become the sort of entirety of her painting. That becomes the sole subject. But that she's really using color as form, starting to kind of eliminate the contour line and use color as form. And you know, for me, in putting together the show, and I can talk a little bit more about this afterwards, I felt like it was really important to demonstrate how early on Carmen hit upon these ideas that we think of as being so innovative when we talk about someone like Ellsworth Kelly, when we talk about someone like Frank Stella, we talk about Robert Rauschenberg, that Carmen was coming up with very similar ideas, sometimes almost the same ideas, at the same time or in a couple of cases earlier, before. And so that's why for me it was important to demonstrate the early years, that I wouldn't have wanted to do something where it looked like she began painting these very distilled works in 1980 after there had been several decades of other artists doing it. It's important to understand when she really should come into the art history textbook, when her name should begin to appear. So this work, I love all of these ones on this sort of burlap because it is still Paris after the war and certain materials were hard to come by and canvas was one of them. So she tells the story that they would go to these kind of equestrian and farm stores and buy all sorts of blankets and other materials that they would use. And in this case, this was a particular canvas that you would use to put, you would put under a horse's saddle or under the yoke of an ox to protect it. And that's what they would buy and stretch and use as their support because they didn't have access to painting materials. Having said that, she also says that she had early access to acrylic paints, which is really unusual, that acrylic paints are thought to come into play almost a decade later. But she's quite adamant about it and says that they're, you know, early precursors to what we think of as acrylic paints that were being developed in Germany and accessible in Paris in these years. And of course, that would enable her to make these very sharp, precise lines that would help her in terms of her stylistic.
They didn't call them acrylic. They called them
synthetic polymer.
Polymer emulsions.
Yeah. So we're going to get more information on this because the number of conservators I've had to have this conversation with, where I'm like, no, Carmen swears, she, you know, up and down. We took samples before the show closed at the Whitney. We took small samples from a number of paintings, of course, with the permission of the owners, and they're going to be examined at a lab in New York. And so we'll actually have more information on the chemical makeup of these paints. So that will be really interesting to figure out. So
this is the one piece where she kind of pays homage to some of her surrealist friends, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think...
And by the way, it has sand. A lot of the paint is mixed with sand.
Mm-hmm. And the images just don't convey the color, anything. And I will say that that was a real eye-opener for me. And maybe I'll digress here and just tell the story of how the show came about. When we were working to open the new museum of the Whitney downtown, we were going to open with a permanent collection was going to fill all of the exhibition space. So that was about 50,000 square feet of exhibition space with permanent collection. And we had never done that before. And we realized that in telling the story of 20th century, 21st century American art through the collection in that manner, certain gaps would become apparent that wouldn't be apparent if you only had 10,000 square feet to tell, you know, one chapter or a snippet. So in my role as director of the collection, we began this analysis looking at the collection and determining what are the gaps, who are the artists that we forgot, who are the artists that we missed, who are the artists that, for reasons that we would not hold against them now, they might have been discounted previously. And we looked primarily at, from sort of 1900 to 1970, women, artists of color, women who immigrated to this country who were not considered American. And the definition of American in the Whitney's collection has changed over the years. It's sort of expanded and contracted. And Carmen came up as one of the artists that we probably should have been looking at and that we might want to consider including in the collection. So we sort of divided, we all had assignments, and my assignment, because I actually felt pretty strongly about Carmen's work, was to research her work and determine if there was one work we could bring into the collection and that we could bring into the collection in time to present it in the best possible way in the opening show, if it would be suitable. And as part of that project, I went to see as many works as I could by Carmen. And what I found, and I'm coming back to this photo, is that the photos I had of her work never came close to the object in real life. I mean, it's always the case. You know, as a curator, you never want to write just looking at a photograph. You want to go and see the work. But I found it to be so much the case with Carmen's work, more so than ever. And part of it was the color. Part of it was the condition. Part of it was the way that the images were often cropped so that the edges were removed. And you couldn't see that she was, in many cases, actually painting the edges, and that those were crucial portions of the composition, the way that the edge interacted with the front face was kind of the hook, the crux of the matter. And I realized that none of the works could be appreciated really, I didn't think fully, unless they were seen in the flesh. I also realized that in seeing more works of hers, I began to appreciate each one even more. That sort of the intelligence of her project, of her effort, was only clear to me when I saw 14, 15, 16. So, of course, I wanted the Whitney to buy 14, 15, 16 Carmen Herreras, but that didn't play. That didn't pan out. But what I could do was argue for a show, because those are the two most compelling reasons to organize a show. Something that is better understood when seen in the flesh, and something that is, it's the two most compelling reasons to organize a monographic show. And a work, an artist whose work really is only understood when you see it in large groupings en masse. And so that was when I started proposing the exhibition. It was really around the time, the same time, I had it in my head. I don't think I shared it with you until we had already bought the painting.
Sure.
So in any case, we did buy a painting in 2014. The museum opened in 2015, and the painting was hung in a room with Ellsworth Kelly, Frank Stella, Agnes Martin, John McLaughlin, Joe Baer, and Jasper Johns, and more than held its own. I mean, it sung. So anyway, this painting's in the show, and if you look at this image and then you look at this painting in the flesh, you'll see a little bit of what I'm talking about. But that was a very long digression, but I'm saving that. It's usually the question I get when I ask for questions. Want to say anything?
This was, as a matter of fact, I was talking to her about this yesterday. In 1950, she went to Havana because they invited her to have an exhibition at the Lyceum. And she decided to do the painting in Havana. Now, this is what was going on in New York in 49 and 50. And she had to convince herself and others that she could handle action painting on New York school, and she could. To me, these are beautiful examples of that style. She did it extremely well. The show was a huge failure. Havana was not ready for this in 1950, and she remembers it as a very unpleasant experience. The show did receive some critical acclaim, but popularly, it was not popular at all. She says, people would open the door to the gallery, close it, and go somewhere else. And she also remembers that it was a particularly hot year in Havana, and there was a lot of mosquitoes, and that When she looks at the painting, she thinks about the mosquito bites.
And also her mother. Wasn't her mother bothering her?
Her mother was on her case, yes. Her mother was the first feminist in Cuba. Her mother was. Her mother was a journalist in the year 1900 in Havana, a Latin American third world country. And her mother was quite a formidable person. Anyway, that's the story of this. She did about 12 or 15 mm-hmm. of them. Mm-hmm. And this is the studio in Paris. We know it now exactly where it is. It's at number 5, Rue Campagne Première, which is in Montparnasse, very near where Picasso was. But you should all notice that her paintings, there isn't a scent of Picasso in them. And she tells a great story. She says that anytime anyone gave her a print, a book, an article about Picasso, she would thank them very much and give it to somebody else. She did not want Picasso in the house because she felt that Picasso had the evil eye. And that anyone that looked at Picasso for too long ended up painting like Picasso. And that is true. That is true. Half of Latin America went to Paris to visit, and they all went back to Latin America to do Picasso. But she wouldn't. She would not.
Isn't the story usually that Picasso comes to your studio and you turn your paintings around because he steals, but Carmen refused. Some more. So this is, we have, I think, another slide of the painting that you see on the right uh-huh. there. And some of the works that you see in these images, we don't know where they are, which is both amazing and kind of an interesting puzzle and mystery, but also worries you a little now that she's getting so much attention.
They do crop up once in a while now.
So there's that one. You can see it on the easel. And there's Carmen. Is she pretending to be?
Look at this woman. This is 10 years. Remember the pictures of her sitting in Washington Square, really scared like that? And look at her now, you know, in Paris, playing it up. And look at the work. I mean, the transformation of the Paris years mm-hmm. was really pivotal. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Just as returning to New York was pivotal later on. But
right.
I mean, if you compare the work that we have looked at a little bit to the work that we saw that she was doing, experimenting with at the Art Students League, you see. It was a revelation. Paris was her, mm-hmm. she found herself there. Mm-hmm.
She found her voice. So this is kind of this amazing moment. She's still in Paris in 1952, and I think this is kind of the moment where those elements that become part of her signature style really come into play. So she did a series of black and white works in 1952, and I think you see here that she's now distilled it to two colors, that she's actually, again, not using contour lines, that diagonal stripe that you see run through the painting. It's just a color shift. She's not actually making a line. It's just that the diagonal bars of color end and then flip to their inverse. She's also painting the frame. So I don't know if you can see this, but you know, at the tip, at bottom and top of each bar, each color, there's just a tiny strip of the opposite color. That's the frame. So she's starting to incorporate the physical support, those elements, into the work. And this is where I think, you know, it was interesting, you know, just talking about objectness and the objecthood of painting and Donald Moffat. This is where Carmen is making those early assertions that the painting is an object on the wall. It's not a window onto a reality. It is an object. And this is also a four-panel painting. So she's using the edges of the four panels to create line or to reinforce the lines that are there, as well as the frame. So it becomes as much sort of a, you know, almost two-dimensional sculpture on the wall as anything else. And these are the sort of the groundbreaking developments that artists such as Rauschenberg and Frank Stella and Kelly, to a certain extent, get credit for right at the same time. So again, this is kind of why it's important to do a show such as this and why it's important to begin with the early work. But I don't think I would have done the show if I hadn't been able to include this crucial grouping of works from the Paris years. And they do have this sort of optical effect, and people have said, you know, is this op art? And she has said, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but whatever sort of, you know, physical manifestation, whatever impact it has on the rods and cones in your eyes, that is, you know, incidental. It's an afterthought. That really she was trying to boil things down to kind of the most essential properties and playing with color and line.
Yeah, she claims that the optical effects are a means to an end, and not an end in itself. In op art, or what is normally known as op art or kinetic art, sometimes the optical effect is what the artist is trying to achieve. In this case, it's obviously not that. There are other, like you so eloquently said, there are many other elements working in together. And she always says, I'm not an op artist, I wasn't interested in op, it's just I was interested in using it as a tool to get to what I wanted to do.
Mm-hmm. So this is a work that's not in the show, but you start to see here this particular triangular shape. So this is a four canvas panel work, and if you see the faint lines dividing the four panels, you can see that each one is blue with a white triangle, and then you put them together and they create this chevron. But that white triangle is what ends up appearing again and again and again. And so Carmen has, at this point, started to create a set of parameters. And for her, this is very liberating and freeing. If you create a set of parameters, and then all you really can do is dive deep into it, then in a way that opens up a world for you. And that happens, I think, with a lot of artists, where if everything's on the table, then you're not as inventive. If you create these strict rules, and then you have to think about the various permutations within those rules, that's where the innovations start. So this is one of my favorite paintings called Equation. And it looks like it could be two panels and that there's a line dividing those two triangles. But really, it's just a thin edge of black, almost as if these two different triangles have sort of slipped from their edge. And I like it because it then creates these six triangles, the two white ones and the four black ones. And those become sort of part of her visual vocabulary that she uses and reuses over and over again. But you also have this sense of movement, that these could be sort of sculptures that are almost slipping off their axes. And that becomes important to me because so much of her work, I think, is thinking about three-dimensional objects and rendering them as paintings, or thinking about movement, the way that you might move around a work, or the way that a composition might change slightly if you just shifted the various elements within. Okay, so this is the painting we bought in 2014, the Whitney, and it's actually two panels, and the entire bottom panel is white. The edge is at the bottom of the green triangle. So again, the edge, the support, is reinforcing the compositional elements. And you have that same kind of wedge that's just kind of doubled back to back. And I wish I had, I don't have here, on the backside, you see many of her paintings, you see kind of abandoned canvases on the backside. She didn't have enough money to be buying multiple canvases, so if she didn't like composition, she would flip it over and try. So we have sort of a variation of this one that was less successful in the back, but again, that same wedge triangle that you see. And in the installation, this is not in the show, this is the Smithsonian's work, which is in a show that's traveling right now about Latino art, so we couldn't borrow it. But I think when you see the Blanco e Verde works together, that she worked on from 59 to 71, she considers one of her most important series, that's when you understand them, I think, the best. And there was an art history class that was coming through the galleries today, and the teacher was asking the kids, would you have hung all of these works together in this room like this, or do you think it would have been a stronger presentation to scatter the green and white works throughout the show? She was asking her students this question. I was really trying to listen, see what they were saying. But my feeling is that seeing one of these doesn't convey to you her project, that you don't understand the intelligence, the sort of the nuances of every permutation, the sort of proportion of color. And you don't get the sense that, you know, she is almost taking these objects and kind of turning them in her mind, you know, that they are shapes, like that they're facets that she's cutting out of. Nor do you understand that really you have to understand each painting as you walk across it, so that there are paintings where three of the edges are green, and you don't see that from the front, and you don't see that from one side. You have to see it from the other side, or you can barely see a green halo on the wall. And that painting makes more sense when you see it with something that's maybe almost its inverse. And together, they create this kind of visual ricochet, where you have the sense that she really is kind of playing with these ideas, and that one becomes more clever when it's seen in the context of six or seven others. So for me, that was always going to be the heart of the show. I wanted that to be kind of the centerpiece of the Whitney presentation. And it's just kind of wonderful the way it works out here in the Wexner with the slanted walls, because it just kind of enhances and reinforces the angles. The architecture of the space works so well with Carmen's work, because she is, in a way, you know, she says architecture is her first love. She's an architect making paintings.
It's true.
So some other iterations. And I think they're probably about 17. I think there are 15 that we know of that are existing. And then we found photographs of two that we don't know where they are.
Right.
And then this is a sort of a variation, red with white. And Carmen often uses the same color combinations over and over again. And she says that she likes the green and white because she says as a pairing, it's like yes and no. She wants two colors that can stand up to each other and two values that can stand up to each other. And very often you see certain color pairings come with certain shapes. And it's not that she has rules, and she comes to everything very intuitively, but she is predisposed or inclined to use green and white with triangles, or red and white with triangles. But I've not seen yellow and white with triangles.
And there's also always the element of a slightly eccentric, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, why not in the middle, you know? Or why in the one that's at the Whitney,
mm-hmm.
she has a totally empty blank canvas sustaining the upper panel. There's always this edginess about her compositions that differentiated from other hard edge painters and
mm-hmm.
makers.
Right, it's never the easy out.
No, there's always. This is Jesse and Carmen. I calculate this must be 64 or 65 something.
65.
Is there a date?
Yeah, because remember the checklist we found for the 65 show? Yeah.
And that painting, which I think is so beautiful, is missing. So if look in your basement. Because...
But she made a new version of
but
it.
But we guessed what the title
yeah.
is, right? Beacon.
Process of elimination, we figured out it was Beacon.
Beacon.
And then after we found this photo and the announcement that had it featured on the cover,
yeah.
didn't she make Beacon 2?
She has Beacon 2, which is at the museum in Philadelphia now.
Yeah, Philadelphia bought that painting.
Mm-hmm.
Another one to
come. Here's Jesse as a photographer. He was really fascinated with, and around this time, this is when in the late 60s, early 70s, when New York started getting dangerous, and somebody broke into their house and took his beloved camera, and he never took pictures again. What a loss, because he was a really good photographer.
This is the show where you and
this is a
Carmen
show.
Met?
Yeah, you know, in those days, they used to have shows like 12 Latin Americans. That was the curatorial intent. And I was in this show. And I went, I think in the next slide, there's... The one is mine, of course, and the other one is Carmen's piece. That piece, which is the next slide? Yes. When I walked into the, this happened at NYU, at the Loeb Student Center in NYU. And I came in with my painting, my regular big painting, hung it on the wall. And I turn and I see what I considered then an elderly couple struggling with this, because this is a fantastic piece. It's made up of two different pieces. So it's balanced gently together. And not only that, it has depth. It's about 3.5 inches deep. And it's made out of delicate wood, painted yellow. And they were having a hard time hanging the painting. And I went over and I said, may I help, you know? And I helped them hang it. And then we talked, and she said she's from Cuba, and I said I'm from Puerto Rico. And I said I just moved to 19th Street. And she said, oh, we've been on 19th Street for 25 years. So it turned out that we were neighbors. And that's how our friendship began. Ironically, that is the piece that is in Dana's exhibition. The cover of the catalog is that piece, which I think is a unique masterpiece.
Well, you can't see it in this presentation, but at the Whitney, the way the show was hung, you had sight lines from one gallery into the next, so that you could see this painting, which is the painting equivalent of this. And so what you see is that this monochromatic work is actually dichromatic, that she was using the green and white, but in this case it was yellow and white. The negative space becomes the second color. But you start to understand that these paintings were in some way envisioned as sculptures. And she was lucky enough, oh, did I go too fast? She was lucky enough to be able to make some sculptures in the 70s. So she had envisioned them in 66, and you see some of the drawings in the show of the works that she was, maybe there's one more I can get, nope. Well, it's the blue, there are two blue estructuras in the room, the last room in the
show. It's my painting. The blue one.
Yes.
You have to go back.
Yeah, okay. I apologize for that. But you see that they really are so directly related both to the drawings that she made and the paintings, and that they are wedges that are cut out, that same triangle that gets cut out on one of the blue ones, or when you light it, a wedge shadow appears. So all of a sudden you've entered into a black and blue composition. But it's so thoughtful and it's so clever, and I think being able to see kind of backwards and forwards that she was thinking about these paintings as kind of three-dimensional, you know, objects, that they had this architectonic inception, is important to understanding the paintings. And then you see when she's able to get a little money from a grant and she hires a carpenter, what she can do with sculpture, which had been her intent, mm-hmm. but was beyond her abilities and beyond Jesse's capabilities as well. But the kind of relationship between the three-dimensional and the two-dimensional, I think, is really important. And for her, she doesn't really think of those as sculptures necessarily. The ones that hang on the walls are paintings on the walls. That's how she speaks of them. And it's very much sort of like Saul LeWitt, you know, someone who's resistant to the kind of traditional notions of sculpture on a pedestal. Do you want to talk about Avila?
Avila. this she did. She went to Spain in the 60s. There's a little preamble to the story. One of her brothers was imprisoned by the Castro government in 1961 or 62. And he was given a 20-year sentence, and he was in real trouble. The brothers were always in trouble, and Carmen was always trying to get him out, not only with the Castro government, but with the governments before. They were very politically active. This brother, Antonio, ended up in prison in Cuba, and Carmen figured that the only way to get him out was to go to Madrid, because she had an uncle who was a very well-known cardinal in the church. And through the intercession of the uncle, she was able to, they were taking out some priests out of out of Cuba, and they had the brother joined in the exodus of the priest. And so, but while in Spain, she really fell in love with her Spanish background, her part of her, and she became very familiar with the work of the Spanish artist, such as Francisco de Zurbarán. Zurbarán.
Oh, no.
It's not here?
Hmm.
Oh, well.
That couldn't have been too fast.
And while she was in Spain, she started doing this series of black and white paintings, influenced by Zurbarán and by Velázquez and by others. And they're really very ascetic. It was a period of time, I consider that, I don't know if you agree, but they were almost, here she is distilling, but distilling as if she is a monk in a monastery or something
mm-hmm,
like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think you said he was a 16th century minimalist.
Yes, he was. Yeah, Carmen always used to say, tell me, if there is a flower or a vase in that painting that can be removed. Mm-hmm. And if it can be removed, the whole painting would fall apart.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, that to her was a definition of a minimalist.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And
yeah. And I think the next image was going to be the Escorial, which was another black and white work from the 70s that was very much influenced by the floor plan of the
palace, the royal palace, yeah.
So you see that Carmen is actually, in some cases, taking, you know, these inspirations or these cues from the surrounding world. Right. It's not.
She was fascinated by two things. Here is the Zurbarán. That is the painting that where Avila, the black there.
Yeah.
That she reduced Zurbarán, who was already a minimalist in the 16th century. To her
yeah.
version
so
of
it's,
it.
Yeah, the arms outstretched.
Yeah, and Zurbarán was a painter. He's known as the painter of monks. He never went and did portraits. He worked in monasteries, and he was very ascetic and very religious.
And I think Carmen, I think that part of it appealed to her as well, because yeah. you know he never really got yeah. paid very much, and you know he had this calling. And yeah. people would always ask Carmen, you know, why do you keep working if you don't have clients? How did you persevere for 70 years with so little positive feedback? And, you know, she has said, you know, it's not about that. I do it because I have to. It's like having a calling. And I think that she identified with that. You know, she has said that, you know, she didn't choose to be an artist. And
yes.
she doesn't like to talk about art. She says, you know, I would sometimes try and get her to talk about things and find a juicy tidbit I could put in my essay. And
you know what she said to a German magazine last week?
What?
When they asked her the same question?
Yeah.
She said, you art about art. You
right.
don't talk about art.
Exactly. You art about art. You don't talk about art. And, you know, she has a certain disdain for artists who spend more time talking about their art than they do making it. And I think, you know, her feeling is if the art's good enough, you shouldn't have to explain it and you don't need words. And I think, you know, we could go deeper into this, but I think, you know, she had many moments in her life that were deeply troubling, and she saw a lot of political upheaval.
So I used to say to her, come on, you can do without those little angels. And she says, if you do that, the robe would fall down. Yes, it's true. You need an angel to hold it up.
All right, let's see if this is going to. So this is Escorial.
That's Escorial.
Okay, so
and
this is
that
the floor,
is the, yeah.
the floor plan.
The nuance here is that Escorial, the architect of the Escorial, was named Herrera.
The one who finished it, yeah.
Yeah. And the other thing that kind of fascinates her is that Escoria in Spanish means garbage dump. And the royal palace is called the Escorial. It was built in a what was then a garbage dump. And of course, there's that unpleasant. You want to tell them about the
barbecue? No, you go ahead. Go ahead.
She was also fascinated. You see, this, if you see it carefully, and this was not her doing. This is the architect of the Escorial doing. There's a barbecue. You see, there's the white forms, and of course, there's a famous Saint Lawrence, to whom the Escorial was dedicated, who suffered martyrdom by being barbecued. And it's one of her dark jokes.
Yeah. Carmen has a wicked sense of humor.
Yeah.
And she likes to gossip.
There she is again.
Sometimes the gossip is from Paris in 1950, but it's always really good gossip. Carmen and Jesse.
You know about Jean, you know Jean Genet? Jean Genet was a crazy playwright and poet and figure in the mid 20th century in Paris who grew up in prison. He was the equivalent of a bad person. I mean, everything about him you would think. And Carmen knew him. And I says, Carmen, how did you know Jean Genet? Oh, he was the sweetest human being. And I'm going, how? And then she starts telling the story that they were in a cafe together, and you know the story, that she's wearing a pearl necklace, and all of the pearls broke, the necklace broke, and the pearls are all over the cafe. And Jean Genet spent the whole night collecting Carmen's.
They were
friends.
Yeah.
And then I found out why they were friends. Because Jesse, here's Jesse again, and that group of New York intellectuals, one of his friends
translated.
Was the translator for Jean Genet and for Simon and Sartre. So he was, and that's what was the connection.
So this is the last body of work in the show, The Days of the Week. And I think, you know, when I was talking about equation and envisioning them as two triangles that sort of slipped off their hinge, I think you can think about these as being almost two squares that are moving across the space and the background is a different color. But when you see all seven of them together, and they hadn't been together since I think 84, they'd been separated. And Carmen had said that she made them as a series, but they could be separated and stand on their own. She was also very clear that you could hang all seven together and it didn't have to begin on Sunday or it didn't have to begin on Monday and go in order. But you have this kind of syncopated rhythm and you get that sense of movement that I think is really important and something that really only is possible when you have them together and you see them in a series. So here are some photos from Carmen's show in 1984 at the Alternative Museum. And I should say that this was her first museum show. Up until this point, Carmen was in gallery shows.
Museum in quotation marks.
Okay. I'm giving them credit. This is the benefit of the,
it's
the Alternative Museum. But that up until that time, the shows that Carmen participated in were primarily those devoted to Latin American or Cuban art. And I think this was very demoralizing for her. You know, she said, I didn't wake up in the morning to become a Cuban painter or a female painter. I was a painter. And I think, you know, after several decades of it, it was very tiring and tiresome. This began to change, I would say, really only in the 2000s. I mean, she had a great show at the Museo del Barrio in 1998, but that's the Museo del Barrio, and that would have fallen under, you know, an institution devoted to, by that point.
And by the way, that's me without gray hair.
bottom left on the right.
You don't need to go that far.
Sorry. And you see the yellow Estatura and the green and white Blanco y Verde are stacked, actually one on top of the other, although the Blanco y Verde is hanging upside down in that instance, which of course caused us a little concern or posed a challenge if we had it wrong since then or... and then this one has a lovely story.
Yeah, this is the 80s. During the, in the 80s in New York, as you all know, there was this horrible, the AIDS epidemic really hit. And they had two friends who were teachers also, science teachers.
At Stuyvesant
High School. Friends of Jesse and friend of, and they were friendly. And sadly, they developed the virus. One had, and one died, and the other one committed suicide. So it's a sad moment in the, and she did this, these two paintings in their honor. I don't know about the symbolism that cut life as a trumped line or the ups and downs of life. I don't know, but that's the story on those two paintings.
Okay, I'm getting the signal. We need to pick it up a little bit so we have time for questions. This is sort of an interesting avenue to go down if there are any PhD students here who are looking for research topics. Carmen had a friendship with Felix Gonzalez Torres, and this is an installation of Democracy, a Project by Group Material, which was a group in which Felix participated at DIA in 1988. So it's not a relationship that we've been able to really delve into too much, except that we know that they shared a gallery. They showed it a gallery in the 80s together and developed a friendship. He was originally from Cuba, and he included her in some of the projects that he was working on.
That's the painting that is at MoMA right now.
So, which is also upstairs, the 52. And then some later works, just, you know, we wanted to make sure you all knew that Carmen is still working, you know, that the show is 48 to 78, but that her work continued subsequently and is incredibly strong. And had we had more room at the Whitney, I would have loved to have gone on further. But the truth is, and this is always the question I get, why 48 to 78?
That's the black and white exhibition in 1998 at El Museo del Barrio.
Right. Just to finish that thought, when I proposed doing the Herrera show at the Whitney, we organized shows 5-6 years in advance, and I had proposed it in 2014. And by that time, we had almost every space committed up until 2018. And Carmen was 100 years old. And the space that was available was our fifth floor gallery, which is really quite beautiful, 5,000 square feet. And Adam said I could have it if I could pull the show together in basically a year. And I thought, you know what, I really want Carmen to see this. I want her to be able to participate in all of this. It's that important, so let's do it. And then how do we figure out a way to edit it in that we are not diluting the quality of the work, but will sing in that space. You know, too many works in a small space is just gonna be, you know, not helpful to anyone.
And when I was, when that story was told to Carmen, she did say, you're asking me at 100 if I wanna have a show at 106?
Right, that was—
Let's do it now.
Yeah, yeah. It didn't. It wasn't really. I don't think.
I mean, I reduced it.
Yeah, yeah, it's true.
I distilled it for her.
Yes, she would have taken up the whole fifth floor. So, some relatively recent works.
Here, she reduces it to one color.
Because that's just the bare canvas.
Yeah, what is beige is raw canvas.
And again, those triangles just keep coming back. And here's Carmen working. So her process is to begin with drawings. And she figures out various compositional elements, the color combinations, sketching, and used to do everything, but now works with a studio assistant who helps her translate her drawings and her ideas into the finished canvases. But she gets up every morning, most mornings.
She's still doing it, yeah.
She goes to her table and she makes these drawings.
She has the occasional scotch, wine every day with lunch. And now she's become a vegetarian. So for 100 years she ate steaks, and not at the age of 100 she becomes a vegetarian. That's the key to a long life.
If you get there. So Carmen taught me how to drink scotch. I didn't drink scotch before, and I would come and do these studio visits with her, and it would be 11, and she would pour me a scotch. And I have a Southern mom. I never say no. I'm trying to be polite, and I don't really like scotch. Now I like scotch, but And finally, I, you know, would get back to the office and it would be 2 o'clock and I was just a mess. Like, I couldn't do anything. So I started going to visit Carmen at 2. And then at the end of those meetings, I would sort of stumble out at, you know, 5, 6. And then I would just go home from that point. But they were, you know, memorable and edifying. And now I like scotch.
She thinks I have some kind of a disease because I can only drink at night. She looks at me and says, "You must be like a bat." I said, "Do bats drink?"
So here she is, hard at work. And she's going to turn 102 in May. So we have a couple of slides of the Whitney presentation, just so you can see how it differs. So that was the opening wall. It's not all that different in terms of presentation, except for the fact that the days of the week, which come at the end of the show here, actually end up being sort of what you see when you step off the elevator at the Whitney. But the basic groupings, and Michael, who did the installation here, you know, I think was incredibly sensitive to the history and the chronology and was, you know, just a very good colleague. So this is the Blanco y Verde room. And just past that wall on the right is the wall that hangs the yellow estructura. So you have that sight line all the way across. And there's really, Tony and I were saying, there's no bad angle to capture this room. I mean, there's less good angles, but there's always something that you can see. And I feel that I saw all of these resonances and saw ways that the works interacted with one another after we installed the room that I had never anticipated. There were certain things I was working for and wanted and planned, and then there were all these things that were not serendipitous because Carmen knew all along. She understood what she was doing, but I didn't anticipate fully. And again, the lighting's really important. A lot of these sculptures cast these amazing triangular shadows, or there are shadows cast within them, or the cuts within them provide these wedges of negative space. So that's the days of the week. So depending on how you look at it, that's 5 of the 7. It's either the first or the last thing you saw. And the drawings. I think that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you. So do we have time? One or two, we have time for one or two questions. We went on too long. And I'm supposed to repeat the question for the... Any questions?
There's something that caught my attention right there, though, because that red sculptural one, which is the tilted one, was in the same position as the one you saw as being upside down on the wall before.
Mm-hmm.
So it is flipped in one version of it.
Right, yeah. Right. Although if you go around the other side of it, it's the other. So that was the big decision, which way to install it, you know, and we tried both. And we actually installed it incorrectly the first time. We installed it because it's two parts. We installed it upside down before we realized. But yeah, that was one of the decisions to make. No, there was no disdain, and she was a joy to work with. Did she give me these, eloquent 6-paragraph answers that would have translated well into my essay and my, no, she did none of that. I mean, you know, she really doesn't like to talk about her art very much, and you would have to give her a very specific question, and then she would answer. One of my favorite stories is there's a New York Times article where a journalist is trying to get her to speak about her work. And she said, "Well, if you were a teacher, Carmen, how would you talk about your work to your students?" And Carmen said, "Well, I would never be a teacher." And she said, "Okay, if you had a small child and you were trying to explain your work to a small child, what would you say?" And Carmen said, "I would give that child some candy so its teeth would rot." And the journalist keeps persisting, and so she goes into a different tangent and says, you know, some people see a lot of sexual imagery in your work, and says that, you know, that those triangles are very sexual in nature, and what do you say to that? And Carmen said, well, for me, sex is sex and triangles are triangles. So, you know, I mean, and that captures it all, you know. So I think there were times where I would ask her questions about process. I would ask her about certain things, and she would give yes or no answers. But she wasn't going to wax on about it. And, you know, she had veto power. If there was something, I was trying to, you know, show her what I was doing as we were going and make sure there was nothing that she hated, that I wasn't making the wrong groupings. You know, was this a Blanco y Verde work? You know, there's one from 56 that's mostly green. That's actually not in the series. You know, things like that that I needed to clarify with her. And she was very helpful. And I think if I had the impression that I was doing something that she hated, she would have told me, and she didn't. I will tell you that when I would go and see works, and I would take photos, and then I would bring them back to her, and I would show her, this is the painting I saw in London, and this is what I saw in Miami, and some of them were the earlier works from Paris, where she's using three different colors, and it's much more of a all-over complex composition, and she would look at it, and she'd be like, oh, you know, it was too much for her. She was like, calm down. She was telling her younger self, calm down, calm down. You know, less is more. You know, it was hard for her to look at some of those works that she, I think, considered transitional. And, you know, that were before she hit upon what she continues to feel is sort of her style and her method. So that, I think, was a little bit difficult. Some of the works that are in the show, I thought were important to include, but I don't know that Carmen would pick those as her most favorite because they're prior to the point where she really kind of got to the essence of what she was working towards. But she's such a pleasure to be with. So, you know, it's hard, even if she's not answering your question about, you know, whether or not she used collage to make these various permutations, she's telling you an incredibly charming story about Picasso and Gertrude Stein from the 40s, so can't complain.
Yesterday I was having lunch with her, and I said something about a cat. And she said, why are you talking about a hat? So I said, you know, Carmen, maybe it's time to call. She has this wonderful hearing specialist who works with opera stars. And I said, maybe it's time to call your doctor. And she said, yeah, maybe we should call him and he should try and figure out what's wrong with your speech. So it describes her. She's witty and funny and very, very positive. If you want the secret to living to 102 before, besides becoming vegetarian at 100, is you really have to see the glasses half full. And she always does.
All right, should we do last question?
Yeah. Well, I know that she was very good friends with Soto, the artist Soto. She knew Alejandro Obregón. She knew some of the people who were in Paris, but most of the friends that she had in Paris were French. And she did not mix that much with the Latin Americans. She she's Cuban. She's clearly Cuban. She loves the food, the music, the history of the country. But you know, she's a painter, and that's how she. And a lot of these other artists, they passed each other, but she never joined movements and things like that. The She was friends with Wilfredo Lam, very good friends with Wilfredo Lam. She was friends with I'm forgetting now, other Latin Americans, but at the same time she was friends with Jean Genet and with Mark Rothko. She tells stories about Mark Rothko. She says, you could be in a party in which there were 75 people having a dancing, having a great time, and he would walk in and everybody would sit down. I mean, it's sad.
Yeah.
But I knew what she was trying to say, that he was really, he really had a cloud over his head. And when they knew him in Paris, you know, they kept trying, let's go to the theater, let's go to this. No, I don't feel like it. But on the question of, there was very little interaction on the aesthetics. She continued on her, and her being ignored, to her, was a form of liberation. See, that's how she saw the glass half full. She did not become bitter. She did not become angry. She did not, she said, you know what that means? That means I can do whatever I want. And she's a marvelous human being.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.